It's not Dixon that will do the presentation. It's Ishmael. Rather me, Ishmael.
Oh, okay. Ishmael, you are welcome.
Thank you.
You are presenting on Pan-Africanism and Ghana's foreign policy.
Foreign policy, yes.
Solidarity to commodification of African
diaspora. Yes.
Yeah, then you can go ahead if you are ready.
So, of course, yeah. I'm presenting on behalf of the two of us. We are both research fellows at the Directorate of Academic Planning and Quality Assurance, University of Cape Coast. Our topic tried to look at the current trend in Ghana's foreign policy in relation to the African diaspora. During the Declaration of Independence, the first president made a statement that is the priorities, actually in relation to Africa, I would like. And he said that the independence of Ghana is meaningless. And indeed, that was a statement that point to the direction that people point to now became one of the building blocks of Ghana's foreign policy, regardless of the regimes and the various leaders that have had the chance to govern Ghana. Somehow, this aspect of Ghana's foreign policy has been enduring. So, when we return to democratic rule in 1993, a lot has changed. From things we have become more centered on the economy. So given the active emphasis on economic diplomacy under the Fourth Republic, our people just seek to understand what is the implication of that for other foreign policy, particularly the ideal of power. To do this, we adopt a grounded theory methodology within a qualitative research framework, and we start off qualitative data, analyzing them systematically that are capable of being generalized into a theory. Two concepts that we use, of course, the key concept of Pan-Africanism is very important. Of course, there are various conceptions of Pan-Africanism, but in the ideologies and movement that have at their center, the notion of and the African and its diaspora. We define the diaspora as all people of African descent outside the continent of Africa. And of course, in foreign policy, we simply refer to all policies directed towards actors of Ghana. So we do a kind of Ghana's foreign policy prior to the Fourth Republic, and you find that the first president from independence to 1966, Ghana was actually the center of Pan-Africanism. Indeed, when Ghana got independent, it was seen as a home for the Pan-African struggle for various reasons, including the fact that the first president actually is an influential leader in the Pan-African struggle. And therefore, we pursue vigorously the idea of Pan-Africanism. Indeed, the various conferences were organized in Accra in the pursuit of the idea of Pan-Africanism. And if you look at the foreign policy making infrastructure or architecture under the First Republic or from independence, you will realize that under the presidency, three institutions actually deal directly with issues of Africa and the African diaspora. Indeed, you have the African Affairs Secretariat, which deals with issues relating to Africans or African countries. Then you have the Bureau of Foreign Affairs that deals with African freedom fighters, independent colonies. And then you have the African Affairs Center that addresses issues of freedom fighters who were then hosted by Ghana. Indeed, African nationalists sought refuge in Ghana and were provided a base. So, indeed, Ghana, for instance, made a point that Ghana was unraveled. Almost all Black radicals who were. So, it was a key element when it comes to the first president in the First Republic. It was the heartbeat of Kwame Nkrumah's foreign policy orientation because his brand of scientific socialism assumed that without a united Africa, Africa got no chance of standing the might of the powers that be. And this should be understood within the context of the Cold War environment that Ghana gained independence. And therefore, he perceived or understand that the only way for Ghana and all the other countries to have a way within that environment was through having also when the CPP and Nkrumah was overthrown in 1966, somehow the idea of Pan-Africanism watered down for other of foreign policy. Indeed, OAU, the Progress Party and the National Liberation Council, actually first president and the CP, indeed, some of the policies of that regime policies, and therefore Ghana re-embraced more or less a policy of total liberation of Africa, reminiscent of what Kwame Nkrumah was, and indeed, to help in the Pan-African struggle, the anti-colonial struggle. A Liberation Information Center was opened in Accra to help Pan-African movement to free the African from colonialism and of course, to give the African personality a new image in the world. So that regime also brought some great. Of course, then Rawlings, the first coming and the second coming, which was the longest in 1981, also leveraged on the orientation, but they could kind of make what is generally considered in Ghanaian politics as the U-turn, where he reapproached the IMF and the World Bank, and then therefore have to undergo a structural adjustment. That somehow set a pattern which in the Fourth Republic will affect how Pan-Africanism unfolds. So during the process of structural adjustment, we were to liberalize the economy, and therefore neoliberal orientation to foreign policy was birthed. Areas like tourism, therefore the process to commercialize more or less cultural and part of that process of liberalizing the Ghanaian economy. And what then happened is that it led to a situation where the African diaspora were considered as target market for tourism, not because they are just brothers of Africa that needed to be united with the rest of us to promote the common good. Now, So, of course, centers of importance such as the West Center, Memorial Center, where it was opened. And of course, this first, the Pan-African Panafest was instituted. So a number of, when we came to civilian rule, 1993, the constitution actually provided the broad framework for Ghana's foreign policy in Act 40, that's the under the directive principles of state policy. You will find a number of principles that should guide Ghana's foreign policy. For instance, we talk about protection of citizens, promotion of just and equitable world order, among others, as the broad framework. Now, you see the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. They define the objectives of Ghana foreign policy in the following terms: promotion of good neighborliness, regional integration, economic diplomacy. And they sum up what Ghana's situation should be by insisting that currently their policy should be pragmatic oriented, particularly towards economic development of Ghana. So largely, we move to a process of liberalization, and that liberalization has been carried onto the Fourth Republic, where foreign policy is in more at ensuring the economic development of the state. Now, so a number of activities that naturally should have been done under the Pan-Africanism, as in uniting, showing solidarity with the African diaspora and bringing Africans together, have now assumed an economic undertone. So a number of things were instituted under this process. The aim actually is establish Ghana as a homeland for Africans in diaspora. If you look at the Ministry of Tourism's policy document in 2002. And indeed, so things such as the institutionalization of the Emancipation Day in 1998, the homecoming summit that attracted a number of the African diaspora, particularly the African Americans in 2001. Were seen as activities aiming at promoting tourism in Ghana and helping to generate revenue for the state instead of the original intent of promoting solidarity with our brothers who have been dispersed as a result of slavery or forced movement. Now, of course, we also had the Joseph Project as part of the 50th anniversary celebration of independence. The celebration of Ghana, where we attempted to say that they are returning, particularly the former descendants of former slaves were returning, just as the biblical Joseph and his brothers. Although some question if that is actually the case, since in this case it is the victim that is coming back to more or less meet those who were complicit in slavery. Now again, recently we organized the Year of Return. Indeed, when you consider all these activities, indeed they look very genuine in terms of making Ghana the home of the African diaspora, creating a pathway, a gateway to connecting with their roots. Both government and the people of Ghana through some of these events. It leaves the impression that we are more concerned with the revenue that these people coming will generate, the beat of Pan-Africanism. So more often than not, when the Year of Return was organized, you will see that hotel prices, other items that they needed were shot up dramatically. This gives the impression that more or less we see ordinary Ghanaians see the African diaspora as more or less a money-making machine. This view, conception, contradicts the original philosophy, spirit behind Pan-Africanism. And indeed, the government or investment into Pan-Africanism seems to be geared towards promoting their investment in Ghana, their remittances, and their, of course, the revenue revenue that we can generate from tourism. And so therefore the focus on this angle of Pan-Africanism seems to cloud the original intent of trying to get parcel of us. Indeed, if you look at the Citizenship Act, you will then get a clearer picture that within that act, well, we try to create a home for Africans in the diaspora who wish to become Ghanaians by granting them dual citizenship. We equally restrict their participation in politics in certain areas. For instance, they could not become members of parliament and so forth and so on, beholding dual citizenship. Some of these issues actually speak to the fact that while we welcome them for their economic value, we are not welcoming them in the sense of the original intent of Pan-Africanism, that is uniting African people and giving them one voice in the world. So there's always this divergence of interest. While the African diaspora, particularly descendants of former slaves, are desperate to reconnect with their roots, government and the people of Ghana seem to operate with that economic logic of seeing them as a source of revenue and therefore commodity item, more or less. So the notion, as it were, of African unity and solidarity that underpinned the earlier forms of Pan-Africanism during the Nkrumah days has now been replaced by the economic logic of it. And so it seems as if that's how their forebears were sold into slavery for gain for self-centered Africans. The current effort to attract them back home is operating on the same logic as to what government and people can generate from their coming, and therefore need to be united with us. Indeed, the same logic can be seen in the AU's own conception of what the diaspora is. Indeed, in living outside the continent, irrespective of their citizenship and nationality, and who are willing to contribute to the development of the continent and building of the African Union. Indeed, I consider that the last part, the second part of the definition is problematic, because to be African, you must not necessarily be willing or ready to contribute. You are African because your root is African. So that essentially highlights the fact that we are looking more at them as agents of development of Africa rather than as victims who need also our support. So it's like we are focusing more on who get from them rather than what they will get. At the end of the for Pan-African spirit and intent of Pan-Africanism, that is uniting Africa. I'm off now.
Hello, Ismail.
Yeah, hello.
Yeah, thank you very much for that wonderful presentation. We thank you for drawing our attention to the fact that we seem to shift from Pan-Africanism to making economic gains or economic logic from the African diaspora. For the sake of time, we will just allow one comment or one question with regards to Ismail's presentation.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yes, my name is Kwame Zulu Shabazz. I'm African American. I've been to Ghana many times, going all the way back to 1997, my first PANAFEST. My question is, I think the brother raised some good points about this shift in diaspora as a source of revenue versus the historical idea of Pan-African connection and unity. The typical response to that, I think, would be that it has to, the change has to come. Can you guys hear me okay?
Yes, please. You can go ahead.
Okay. Right. The change, right, is not going to come from the leaders. It has to come from the grassroots up, from the people up. And so I wanted to get a sense for the brother, you know, his own perspective on how the average Ghanaian sees this situation. How does he think that, or in his experience, how do Ghanaians understand diaspora? Is it more something about something to be gained in terms of property, or more in terms of the historical idea of Pan-African connection?
Yeah, Ishmael, can you respond to that for us?
Yeah, thank you. As I've indicated, the ordinary Ghanaian see the African diaspora as being better off and therefore a source of income, or as I put it, a money-making machine. So therefore, the general population seems to lose touch with the historical significance of the diaspora. So I see the population having also moved away from the historical significance to seeing the diaspora as people who are better off, people whom they can benefit from.
Yes, Dr. Mario, you also wanted to ask a question.
Yes, the question I have was basically, I'm curious about this in many ways, because I think that groups gain wealth and resources. So I'm wondering, what is the level of resources the Ghanaian state is obtaining from this means of
Hello, Ishmael.
Yeah, hello?
Yeah, can you respond to that for us?
I didn't get the question.
You didn't get the question.
It's the line break at a point. So,
Dr. Mario wanted to know, in estimates, by estimation, how much does the diasporans bring into Ghana as a resource for us to capitalize on the fact that we are making money from them?
Okay. I won't put a figure on it, but what I can say from the readings that we have so far done is that from a very low level to the point of commercialization of tourism rise to become the third largest foreign exchange earner of Ghana. And most of these earnings were actually driven by to visit sites in Ghana. So of course I will much deeper to look at the exact figure that it contributes to bring into Ghana. But then it is about people's perception. It's also about how people are viewed. All right. So of course, thank you for drawing attention to that. I will look at the exact figures and maybe I'll present it in the paper. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ishmael. With this response, we will break for the next session. At least the next session will be starting at 3 p.m. So we have about an hour break. So we get up, we stretch, and then we come back for the next session. Thank you very much, participants, for coming to this session.